Good day, everyone, physically and virtually. This is the first panel, and it's a very important one in my view, largely because of the composition. We have with us presently three of the four panelists. Mr. Fotis Kourmousis is expected. He's the Special Secretary for the Management of Private Debt, and remarkably, he served in that position for the last decade under all governments that have governed the country during that rather tumultuous decade. We have also Michalis Karalabidis. He's the Chief Risk Officer for the HFSF, and in that capacity he has seen the great banking crisis and the way out of it, hopefully the way out of the NPL crisis as well. We have Thodoris Athanasopoulos. He's currently the CEO of CEPAL, one of the larger services associated primarily with Alpha Bank, where Thodoris came from, and he's, in my view, the most experienced restructuring practitioner in this country. And last but not least, we have Dimitris Kanellopoulos, who is the head of legal at Attica Bank. Attica Bank is the smallest of the major Greek banks. It was the first to try various NPL solutions, including securitization, successfully. And so he's got a lot to share with us today. I was going to start with the government, but we can start with another agency, an important agency, which is the HFSF. And Michali, perhaps you can tell us something about where we have come from, that sort of rather laborious experience that we had in dealing with NPLs, and what is your sense of the evolution to date and your expectation for the near future?
Yeah, thank you, Stathis. I think I had prepared a slide for, you know, for the introduction, just showing the, because, you know, one picture is worth more than 1,000 words. So I don't know if you can, I don't know. Anyway, can we see the slide, please? Okay, fine. So here you can see the evolution of NPLs in the Greek banking sector. The gray bars are the NPE amounts in billion of euros. The blue line is the NPE ratio. The data comes from the Bank of Greece. So as you can see, we started in 2002 with almost only 7 billion of NPEs. And of course, because of the crisis, we climbed to 100 billion in 12 years. There are, you know, I have put some major events in the red lines, you know, the capital controls, the PSI, the start of the crisis, et cetera, et cetera, and the COVID-19. Today, actually, the latest available data that we have is for June 21. We're around with an NPE ratio of 20%, almost 20%, and for the first time after many, many years, more than 10 years, we are below 30 billion. Of course, you can see that this a rapid, deceleration, decrease, the last quarters, mainly because, we'll talk later, the large mega NPE securitizations performed by Greek banks, which in Hercules we will discuss later about this. Now, okay, the trajectory is good, is strong. We feel very happy for this, but bear in mind that the weighted average NPE ratio in the EU is 2.5%. Okay, we are 10 times, even now, higher than the EU. Of course, if you see, you know, countries in Southeast Europe like Portugal, Spain, Italy, they are from 3 to 4%. So we're not yet done with NPEs, unfortunately. And we have to continue our efforts. Now, what about the future? If we manage to avoid, let's say, negative surprises like, you know, to have, you know, a bad evolution from COVID or, you know, and other exogenous problems, I believe that the Greek banking system can go below 10% between the first and the second quarter of 2022. And I think the target of the Greek banking sector should be 5% between the Q1 and Q2 of 2023. Maybe this is my personal view, but I think this is where we have to target if we want to be close to, you know, Southeast Europe, Spain, Italy, Portugal, etc. So I think this is the main issues. Now, about what will be the main drivers of this, you know, if we target these two ratios. First of all, I think, is the quality of the new loans, because the NPE ratio is, you know, NPEs over gross loans. So very important is the quality of the new loans that we're going to grant to the economy, you know, the recovery fund, et cetera, et cetera. This, so banks are very strict now in their underwriting criteria. Of course, Hercules and other issues like the implementation of the insolvency code we'll discuss later, the auctions, acceleration, the new civil code procedure. I think we discuss all these things, but these are extremely important. And I think we put the basis, now have the tools for the next crisis. Because back in 2009, 2010, we had nothing. That's why NPEs went so high. I think for the next crisis that might come in 20 years or 15 years or 30 years, now we have the legal and administrative and public tools, I think, to deal better with the crisis. Thank you.
Can I ask a clarification? Does this include NPEs in the hands of NPLs in the hands of services or not?
No.
This is just the banks.
This is just the banks. That's why you see the reduction. So actually, the large part of this have gone to services or to securitization or to funds.
Yeah, okay. Foti, welcome to the panel. Thanks for coming. You have lived during the last decade through the crisis, and you've seen various attempts at governmental reaction to the crisis. What do you think are the most important initiatives that have been taken in the last several years?
Thank you very much for the introduction and to the organizers. It is the first time that I come physically to an event after 1.5 years. So it seems strange, you know, to look to all of you. I was used to, you know, looking at the screen. So now it's all, but we're going to, you know, grow back into it. So as Michael showed in the slides of all the history of NPL, as the problem started back in some 10 years, immediately there were some measures taken by the government at that time and all the next governments every now and then. So every 1 or 2 years we had a new scheme. All the schemes were temporary, and when they were designed they thought that they're going to solve the problem within 1-2 years. However, lacking of automated procedures and also checks and balances and controls and etc., the problem, as you saw in Michael's slides, kept going up and deteriorated for a series of 5 to 6 years. And then some important measures were taken about creating a secondary market for NPL, and this really started to have an impact. It was actually a proposal made back then by HFSF, where Michael is representing today. As it has happened in other countries, at that time Italy was the number one in this project. And then Hercules scheme came approximately 2 years ago in Greece, which is the state, let's say, supports financially through security, through securing securitizations of NPL transfers. Mm-hmm. So this was a crucial, let's say, turning point in the issue of NPL. However, from the side of debtors, even if NPL change hands and go from the bank to the servicer, as Theodore is representing today, one of the greatest in Greece, from the side of the debt remains the same, and that's why new tools were needed, such as the new insolvency law, which was activated in June, so 3 months ago approximately. And through this law, NPL can be worked out from the side of the debtor, regardless if the non-performing loan resides with the bank or the servicer. So it's a main initiative, and many more initiatives are coming in the future.
What about the amendment of the Code of Civil Procedure? Do you expect that to have an important impact?
Yes, this week. It's currently into Parliament for discussion. We expect it to be voted through some minor changes, amendments, in the next 10 days. And this new Code of Civil Procedures, we believe that it will improve the enforcement measure field, because some of these processes are outdated and conducted manually. For example, e-auctions through, auctions occurring through bankruptcies were still implemented in a manual way. So this has a lot of deficiencies. And one of the main improvements is that they're going to be integrated into the e-auction system, which is automatic and conducted through an electronic platform. Another major improvement is related what happens during the e-auction, where the debtors would go to a court and this would start a court dispute related to the price of the asset. This is again solved by automating some of this process and averting the courts. So we believe that approximately 2 years of, let's say, time will be saved in the overall process of from the time of initiating the enforcement action until its completion.
So, Dori, as responsible for a servicer, do you share this view of the insolvency framework and the amended code?
Well, in short, yes. I would argue that this is a good approach, and we're quite happy to see it moving forward. But I would like to put it in a wider perspective. I think since 2007, a number of amendments on the bankruptcy law, on the enforcement process, on the out-of-court workout have been attempted. And now we have reached out the point where overall the legal framework works. It can become better. It will always get improved, more automated, but it works. I think what certain amendments on the Greek Civil Procedure Code address is the operationalization part, which is really important. Actually, we did not have auction activity for many years. We saw 2019 auctions taking place, then the COVID outbreak stopped things. And I think for the securitization plans to really succeed, we will be seeing auctions in the tune of 40,000, 45,000 or 50,000 per annum in terms of count. This is not something that we have not witnessed as a country. That was the volume in 2008. But the whole ecosystem needs to get an upgrade. Okay, and the ecosystem is the process in courts, is the automatic reduction price where we have seen in other jurisdictions and we think it works. It's also how the bailiff system, the valuer system works. So from now on, the amendments might be coming by law, but they should be focusing on actually expediting, making more transparent the process and more clear-cut. We think that the biggest and most important is the automatic price reduction. This is something that theoretically existed, but it had to happen through court decisions with uncertain timelines and outcomes. And this is now get standardized, which means that for investors and for people you can model, But also investors need to be cautious in the sense that they need also to have a real estate strategy to protect prices and recoveries. So we are moving on to the next era, which is swift operationalization, not crafting the laws. This is what's happened in the past. And this is why we need platforms. This is why we need transparency. For example, to my mind, putting auctions in bankruptcies through the e-auction platform is also a transparency issue, which we need to be very careful going forward, especially because the problem, as we have discussed, has not gone away, has just gone to the next level, has left the bank's balance sheet, which is what it should happen in terms of stabilizing the economy, but the problem needs to be addressed in a swift and transparent way.
Which brings me very obviously to you, Dimitri, now, because we've heard the position of the servicer. How do you see the banks interacting with the services? We've seen that the banks have moved a large part of the problem to the services, but how do they now interact with the services for the best outcome in terms of treatment of private debt?
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank DTC for this fantastic event. As Fotis said, also for me, it's the first time after 2 years that I'm physically on a stage and on an event. And it's a little bit strange not to be on, let's say, on virtual events. So I would like to comment on taking into account three small references, one from Michalis, one from Theodore, and one from the minister before. Michalis said that on 2010-2011 we didn't have any tools. This is the truth. We didn't have risk departments, we didn't have legal means, we didn't have administrative tools, and steadily the state started to give us all these powers, the legal powers, so as to move forward and to make our balance sheets better and better and optimizing them. So then I come to your question and relating with Theodore's comment, that on 2017 our bank managed to have the first securitization with SRT, transferring the risk, I mean, from their balance sheet to other entities. And from these years, the last 3 years, we have seen a lot of analogous projects. But the debt itself remains. The debt is moving from the balance sheet of the bank to other carriers of risk, which is either the servicers, the issuers, or the state itself through the Hercules program. So that means that we try to find on the next day which is the part of the debt and of the risk that remains on the shoulders of the bank. The bank, after a securitization, still is the note holder, and that note holder has a lot of interest for a transaction to be successful. And this is not always taken for granted. Under some prerequisites, it could be successful and could be always stable for the bank's interests, but on the other side, we still have a lot of portfolios or assets that are still in a little, let's say, in not so easily to serve. As a note holder, a bank always till the, I would like to refer first in a no-haps scheme, always has the interest to see its investment, because it changes from handling the debt to investment, it holds the note, to see its investment being bringing bank and being fruitful. This is not always the case, because the procedures that the bank has followed in the past and knows it in a very well manner is not always the procedures that the servicer should evolve. And now what we see, and it's very common in the market, is that we moved all these portfolios to the services so as to find resources to handle these cases, but now steadily the servicers themselves move to a dead-end position on the portfolio handling due to extra volume, due to the fact that the services themselves don't have the internal organization structures, but now have all these assets moving to the servicers. But that doesn't mean necessarily that they are also it's a productive scenario. So then it's the big question. The big question is, what is the bank intending to do, and how is if the bank is authorized to get involved in this servicing procedure? The answer is no. The answer is that the banks today do not want anymore to enter into this NPL handling. It wants to keep, let's say, an auditing role, a respective auditing role, only in the cases that we don't have SRT requisites and only in the cases that we don't have HAP scheme. And we are very, let's say, not that we're not so lucky, I would say we are benefited from the fact that we have the HAP scheme. The HAP scheme, which is, okay, we understand that has a kind of cost for the banks. This guarantee is not for free, the state guarantee. But on the other side, that brings a third part on the risk analysis of the debt. This private debt, if we see it very clearly, it comes to the state through this guarantee. The balance sheet of the bank is well well optimized and well secured. And so we have more than one player on the market. It's not only the bank themselves, but it's also the state and the servicer. And a last comment from me is that our minister referred to the fact that we have a decrease of the NPLs, bad loans, red loans. We can have a lot of, we can baptize them in many ways. This is, okay, this is a tool for the banking system to go forward. But everyone from which is involved in this, what we call bad loan sector, and especially the state itself, should not stay on the fact that the banks are okay, are more stable, and the system also is more stable. The state and the services should look that they have a strategic role now, which is first to cure the relationship between debtor and lender, which is not anymore the bank, and secondly, to secure a new market ethics so as to provide a new code of conduct, let's say, between the lender and the debtor, so as in the next day to have better loans, better ethics, not to have loans that in a way from the first moment we knew that we couldn't be served, and the next day to have a more, let's say, a well-structured risk, not only for the financial institutions or for the state, because through the Hercules program, we have to understand that the state took a lot of load, but also for our society.
Thank you, Dimitri. Mikhaili, that brings me back to you now, because the HFSF, as a major bank shareholder, I believe took the initiative to introduce the Hercules scheme. Now that we've seen it in operation, what's your view of its contribution? Are there any shortcomings, any improvements?
Yes, thank you, Stathis. So please, you can put the second slide of my presentation. Okay, you know, emotionally attached to Hercules, we started working on the asset protection scheme in early 2017. In November 2018, we submit a detailed proposal to the Ministry of Finance. We had the elections, a new government, and hopefully in December 2019, we had the law. We see now, you know, what happens and the benefits of Hercules. This is a very recent graph from Deadwire. As of 1st of October, you see now that Greece is leading the market, has 36% of the gross book value of all transactions. Here we have securitization, outright sales, everything. And you see that Greece is very, very active, becomes now the number one, who actually surpassed the Italians. Of course, if you go back in the past, since 2015, you see that, okay, the Italians have a very big market, but you know, Greece is very active. And I think that the NPL market is not only due to Hercules, but you know, Hercules was a breakthrough there. And I think that the market will be more active in the years to come. And actually, you know, the mezzanine trans are, let's say, listed in the in the stock market. Slowly you start, you know, having let's say a secondary NPL market, which is actually a target also from the European Union. That is a very, very difficult, let's say, experiment. And I think that this will be the case also for the European Union. Now, as you know, Hercules I was extended. Now I think we'll go until October 2022. Yes, the major shortcoming, I think, not going into details, is the acceleration of the decision-making process. We experienced problems, you know, in the first, let's say, implementation of Hercules I. There is a little bit bureaucratic process. I think this can be accelerated. We have a lot of committees. We like very much, you know, to have a lot of committees in Greece. But I think that now things are smoothing out. I think up to now, they have received HAPS recertification or are very near to get their certification. You know, transactions with a gross value around 35, 38 billion. I think that in the next month of 2021, early 22, we have another 10, 11 billion gross book value. And this is very important. You know, banks are very experienced now. They have the teams, they have the skill set, you know, the infrastructure, everything. And now they can, let's say, easily, let's say, deal with this. And of course, as I said in the first place, Hercules, alongside with all the other stuff that we will discuss, of course, the credit bureau, which Fotis will discuss about, which is very important for the future. I think this is a very powerful tool for the, you know, for the next crisis. Thank you.
Mikhail, can I just ask a follow-up question? Is Hercules a tool to assist banks in improving the balance sheet, or does it actually deal with the problem of private debt? How do you see it?
You know, Hercules, you know, the initial idea of Hercules came from Italy. So the GACS, you know, the Italians, they initiated this in 2016. Italian banks were very hesitant in the first place. They had, you know, in 1 year they had no transactions. Suddenly in 2017, this, you know, skyrocketed, and we took the idea from there. We had to travel two or three times in Italy to meet people or the Italians that were working on this. I think this is a major tool for, you know, for banks to reduce their NPE levels. Now, I don't think that this is the major priority to manage private debt, because private debt now has moved from banks to servicers, and you need other tools, Fotis will discuss, to deal with this private debt. So it's mainly for banks.
Okay, thank you very much. Thodori, your job is to deal with the consequences of debt default. So how do you see the COVID pandemic? Do you see more business coming your way as a result of that?
That's a tough one. Okay, I think if we look what's happening currently, theoretically after a recession, you always expect new flows, you expect new defaults. But I think what we have seen is that the system was quite proactive on this crisis. A lot of moratoria have been offered to the clients, and actually we see that the performance of the moratoria that actually elapse is far better than initially anticipated. Oh. So things are moving on. On the other hand, there is a fiscal bazooka out there, where the government is assisting even on keeping payments to borrowers. And the recovery fund is something which is a one-off and creates a huge liquidity on the market. So we need to see Q1 2022, where a lot of these restructurings elapse, but this is not usual, because currently we see all macro variables moving to the positive direction really fast. We see liquidity in the market. For us, if we are to understand macro, we need to understand disposable income, and therefore we need to understand unemployment rates, we need to understand inflation, real estate prices. All these things are moving to direction which theoretically they could offset part of the issue that was created. On the other hand, real factual data we'll be having towards the end of the year in the first quarter of 2022. And what we are expecting to see is the timing asynchrony of moratoria elapsing and liquidity stepping into the market. This is the macro trend is positive, but we need to see how these things will actually interplay in terms of timing. So I don't think this is the typical crisis where we would expect huge NPE flows right after the crisis, but mainly because the whole system, this being a systemic global crisis, has acted in a way, even the regulator, we may say, that assisted initially the banks to actually deal with short-term restrictions to borrowers. So we are cautiously optimistic, but true data points will come up in the next few quarters. And I think the bet is the timing asynchrony issue, not the overall trend.
Dimitri, I'd like to have the point of view of the banks on the impact of the COVID crisis, and perhaps you can make give us a comment on the issue of the payment culture. I remember the Troika being extremely focused on payment culture, the existence, the health of the payment culture, and now with the new moratoria due to COVID, has that impacted adversely on the payment culture?
Thank you. If I'm allowed, I would like to comment on something that Michalis said. Actually, Michalis referred to that Hercules, perhaps, is a tool for the next crisis. Mm-hmm. To be very honest, I disagree with that. I think that the HAPS is mainly the solution for the past, and especially for the balance sheets of the banks, not of the debt problem itself, but for the hygiene and for the health of the bank system. The tool for the next crisis is the answer to the question that you just raised, Stathis, that the banks themselves, 2022 is a very crucial year. It's a year that we return to regularity. So when we check 2010 and then go to year 2022, what we should see? We should see that the whole system, the banking sector, the servicing sector, the lending system, everything has to start working again on a more healthy basis. What happened, what is this healthy and regularity? Is it the same regularity that we had in 2010? The answer is obviously no. The banks, I think everyone can understand it, this is a fact, should only banking. They should not refer and they should not get into the fit of the NPL problem. The NPL problem is here, it will stay. We are going to have new NPLs. We are going to see in the 2022, third time, it's a difficult number for me, 2022, we're going to see new NPLs coming. The picture, at first glance, it is that the problem is not going to be as big as forecasted. All the tools that the government, the fiscal tools that the government and the state provided worldwide and seem to cope with the problem, and we do not expect a big upside down. But on the other hand, you cannot deal with this. It's for sure that we are going to have new NPLs. But the new NPL structures are not anymore on the balance sheet of the banks. The future is that most of the banks, at least mine, were looking for open perimeter securitizations of portfolios that by the moment that a new loan has this delay and is ready to get denounced, this 90-day period, directly it moves out of your books and it goes to a servicer that you are cooperating with, even outside the HAP scheme. This is very important for the balance sheets of the banks because they do not have, they are not going to keep any NPLs, and they also do not they do not need to keep the same regulatory capital requirements due to the fact that this loan is not anymore in the books. The loss from the fact that the servicer needs a kind of fee and this, let's say, cost for the bank is balanced, and sometimes it's overrun by the benefit on the capital requirements. And I would also like to refer to the new credit procedures, that everyone is more wiser and the banks themselves are more wiser. Now we have strong tools. The IT has helped a lot on this. We have the credit procedures and the risk analysis is not the way that they were done in 2005, for example, 2008. I remember myself something like 15 years ago as a young lawyer in the bank that we didn't have at or the risk department simply did not exist. And all the credit procedures were all on committees and on hand. That was the, nothing else. It was simply one human decision or two, three human decisions. Today the IT has provided, the IT developments have provided a lot of tools. So the future, and I'm not talking about the future in 5 or 10 years, it is already happening that the small retail loans are being dealt with on a risk analysis basis and on credit analysis basis, only on just with IT analysis without any human intervention at all. And if the data that is being given to the system allow the customer, the debtor, the client of the bank to take this loan, he will take it, he will receive it. And this is steadily that it's moving also to other categories of loans, to wholesale loans, corporate loans, etc. And you also referred to the ethics of lending. We can see that the Bank of Greece, and I think that all major central banks, have already moved to the from the 2005 perspective, which was the growth, to the 2022 perspective, which is stability. And the stability means that we cannot accept credit, we cannot give credit improvements for all customers, just having mount the targets and the volume of the loans to be given, but now today, percentage of the risk has to be taken by the client. This is the most important, and this is the tool for a future crisis. That is what we have learned from this crisis, and this is hopefully what will stay with us in the future.
Thank you. Yes.
Just one in order not to be misunderstood, I think that Hercules is a last resort tool. Of course, the main, tools are these that will change the payment culture of people. And of course, this is the OCW, the insolvency code, the education, the financial literacy of households, the education of households, the public bureau. You know, Hercules is something that, you know, will be the bazooka when everything other, you know, doesn't work. So definitely, I think these are, you know, the normal way to go. Just for...
Thank you.
Not to forget,
yes,
that the Hercules, okay, it is a big tool, but we do not expect all the loans, all the NPLs to enter into a Hercules scheme. So the services have to find, first of all, it's costly. There is a specific line where a bank or another asset holder, it's not only the banks out there, it's big amounts of private debt. Where he can decide whether he will enter the HAP scheme or not. the payment culture is something that will derive from all these situations. But when these debtors understand that they have all the tools now for their past, to cure their past and to have the second opportunity, that means that you cannot expect a third opportunity in 10 years.
Thank you. Forty, that brings me back to you. And we've heard that the initiatives until now are positive contributions on the whole, I understand. That seems to be the sense. And I'd like to ask you, do you see more initiatives in the immediate future? And specifically, because I know you're an engineer and a professor of engineering, how do you see digital tools assisting us in dealing with private debt?
I took some interesting notes from what Dimitri said about ethics and what Theodore said about data. So, okay, we have the tools, but in order to be able to utilize them and achieve the goals as Michael has presented, all these tools need to be utilized in an effective way. So, In actual part, the data play a very important role, because if you don't have all the data, you cannot make good decisions related to whether you will restructure this way or that way, or you will enforce or whatever. And maybe this leads to wrong results. And that is why in the past 2 years, we have tried to, let's say, digitize the data sources, especially those belonging to the public sector, and provide them to the private sector creditors, such as banks and servicers, so they can do their job as they know how to do it. However, there are still some data sets in the public sector, in some public sector departments, that are not even digital. So they are still kept in books and documents. And that is why this data is accessible, but not in a quick and effective way. So our actions, our upcoming actions for the coming months is to digitize these data sources in their origination point, and provide them to the creditors so they can have a better data set. The first thing that we have targeted is the information from Ministry of Justice related to the insolvency, bankruptcy, rehabilitation, etc., etc. All these things up to date. You have to go to every court throughout the country, and there are something like 400 different courts, to ask to find the certificate, and the certificate is issued in, let's say, a paper. Paper form. So our project is to digitize this, and we believe in the coming months we will have concluded it, and thus this very crucial information will be provided directly and automatically through our platform. Of course, there are several other, such as the asset information, etc. And in order to overall tackle the data set issue, we have in our plans within 2022 to create a public credit bureau, as we call it. And this is a smart way to tackle the GDPR issue. So this scheme will gather all the data from all public sector departments and digitize them and provide them to the private sector market. So they can utilize all this data efficiently, quickly, without having to go to each and every department throughout Greece. This is a major reform project. It has been included in one of the main reforms in the RRF scheme related to the recovery fund of Europe due to COVID. And we believe that by the end of 2022, it will be fully up and running and start to provide all this data. Which, of course, by complementing existing private sector credit bureau, the creditors will have a full, let's say, data set about their clients and be able to give them tailor-made solutions.
Can I ask the rest of the panel, is there something you think the government should be doing as a matter of urgency? Is there some initiative that has not been discussed that should be taken by the government?
Well, if I may,
yes.
The digitization for the processes, the data issue, ictimatologio, the real estate property, and digitization of courts. Mm. Okay, so as I said previously, we are good to go in terms of legal framework. We need to upgrade the platform. This is where we are as a country. And in order to upgrade the platform, there are two things. One is courts and swift processes, simpler processes. I dare to say something should not be so judgmental. I think we all discussed about price reduction. Price reduction, it's not a judgment call. It is what it is. And the whole things that has been announced for Ktimatologio, they're really important. Mm. And I need to make a point.
Ktimatologio is the cadastre.
The cadastre,
mm. Yes.
Yeah. I need to make something very clear. It's important for the state as well, because all this HAPS plan, the Hercules plan, is going through RIOKOS. So the more efficient the process takes place, the probability of a potential redefault goes down, because you might execute the plan and not being able to execute the sales. So it's not only a reform doing these things, given that now we have the Hercules scheme and the government guarantee. It's also a defensive action from the state to make sure that the business plans actually roll out. So I think, to my mind, it's about the platform. The credit bureau, the public credit bureau, would be a game changer, because it will help us work with data. But cadastro and the court operation, the simplification, transparency, and speed are important for the state as well.
Yeah,
I think I remember 5 years ago we worked together at Staffis with the NPL market impediments, which is actually still in our website. The good thing, we also held some progress updates. The good thing is that if you go and read this document, which was written 5 years ago, all these things were there.
Yeah.
And now, you know, it's good because this happened, you know, the credit bureau, the changes in insolvency law, the Caccelli law problems, blah, blah, blah. They were documented on this document. Work to staff this, and I think apart from this, you know, what Theodore said are very important. We had also a proposal about an NPL platform. Of course, now banks are using their own platforms. You know, it was a very, you know, radical and visionary idea. Imagine, you know, a platform where the seller, let's say, chooses the buyers. And the buyers can go and see the asset inside, outside, you know, like you know, what you see in the real estate, you know, but you can see everything. So an investor, I don't know, in the US doesn't have to come in Greece to visit the real estate or whatever, or the house or the villa, or but there is, a platform, an electronic platform that, you know, the seller chooses who is entering, and then there is also a competitive process there. I think there are tools that, and this also can be, you know, considered as an idea.
Thank you. We've got 5 minutes left, I think. We can take questions from the audience if there are any. Yes, please go on.
Yeah, I'm George Abdopoulos from XVM Consulting. Speaking of culture, we have seen all the bright people from the banking sector transitioning to the services. Now, your classical banker thinks in a process-oriented manner. He also thinks, to give you an example, I have a 100 euro NPL. Somebody offers me 50 euros to settle. As a classical banker, rightly so, I think I have a 50% loss, whereas the entrepreneurial RM, who comes with a clean slate, thinks that I have a 60% gain on, let's say, something I bought for 30 cents. My experience is that, and I can quote you, somebody saying, you're offering me 50, I'll register a 50% loss. And then I say, you're not in the bank anymore. This is your best possible solution. And the question is, have all the big, the behemoths, Sapal, Intrum, and Doe Valley, what are they doing to change that culture? If they feel that there is a need to change that culture, but they have to answer to funds as well, not only the banks.
I guess that's for me. Well, we're making a discussion yesterday, so I think there's a short answer which says that things are changing swiftly, but they have not changed entirely yet. I think that's an answer on decision making. But I'll try to link it with the discussion we're having previously on Hercules, and is Hercules something that actually it's a bank deleveraging tool, or is it something that will help the market and help with the resolution of the problem? So Hercules is a bank deleveraging tool, for sure. But on the other hand, it has certain ripple effects which will affect everything. The first thing is that for the Hercules and the recognition to take place, you had to have independent services. So you took out people and units outside the banks. The second thing is that every loan has a transfer price now, so you have the ability to think based on the transfer price rather than the gross book value or total claim. But the third thing is something really different. We did have targets in the banks, but every year we resubmitted the plan. So in essence, we had a budget, not a long-term plan. In Hercules, you have specific cash flow targets that you, and indeed net cash flow targets, to be more accurate, that you need to achieve within a specific yearly period, annually. These targets don't change. So the more you work on the securitization, it's becoming quite important to meet the cash targets. So, and the targets do not change. You can do a rolling forecast, but the targets will not change. So to that extent, the actual ripple effect of Hercules and of sales is that people need to bring a specific amount of cash in a specific time period, and this will change. And to be blunt, I think all the things that are changing, OCW, etc., they will be facilitators, but the real payment mentality and culture of the country will change exactly, because now we'll start talking about specific cash flow per year, and we'll not be talking about theoretical restructurings. So I think, to your answer, this is a mentality switch that all the services need to do. Everybody's moving in that direction. We're not there yet. But I think the way that things are structured, we either comply or fail. So nobody wants to fail. And that's the biggest, I think, power into this scheme.
Well, thank you. I'm afraid we've run out of time. I want to thank everyone very much. I think it's been a very lively and interesting discussion. Thanks to the organizers, too. Thank you.
Thank you.